Let's continue the Congress with the last speaker today, Simon Sheikh, coming from Copenhagen or Berlin. Okay, based in Berlin, as we today used to say. He is a freelancer, curator, and critic. He's currently undertaking doctoral research on the topic of exhibition making and political imaginaries at the University of Lund. Connected to this research, he recently curated Vectors of the Possible, which is a part of the whole project Former West, in Utrecht, 2010. It is the research exhibition within the project. He was coordinator of the critical studies program in Malmö Art Academy, director of Overgarden, Institute for Contemporary Art in Copenhagen, and curator of at NIFCA at Helsinki from 2003 to 2004. There are several more curatorial projects he curated, and of course he writes extensively on art, and there are many of recent publications, but people will get shot a clue about what you write, hearing what you have to say. Okay, thank you. Please.
Thank you, Boris. Thanks for the nice words. And just before I start, since I was also co-organizing this, I would just like to say thank you a lot to Buck for this great collaboration we had in the last year. It's really been excellent. And it's really been great for me to follow these three speakers, because in a way I will try and touch a little bit on some of the things that they also talked about. But first, maybe I just want to, as an introductory remark, to say that it's a little bit experimental in nature, because I will try and look at the horizon as a figure, and therefore also through theory, of course, but to say that it's a figure is also, in my view, to say it's an image, and therefore it has bearings on how we conceive of art, but certainly also how we produce art, and especially exhibitions. So you can say it's a kind of curatorial take on what is a political and philosophical term. And I know that Peter Osborne has written that definitions make for bad philosophy, but for good art. So hopefully this will also be the case here, because I'll try and go through four definitions of the horizon and put them in the context of exhibition making. Okay, and I'll show you a few images also. So it would seem self-evident today to say that art is connected to the imaginary, but which imaginary? What does it mean to say that art imagines or is imaginative? And has imagination, in artistic terms, anything to do with political imaginaries, that is, ideas about the world and society? It's past and present, but also possible futures, possible alternatives. Are there specific imminent features that creates such a connection? Or are there certain points of connection in the terms of figures and institutions? And is the figure of the horizon such a connection? Is the horizon as figure common and shared to both political imaginaries? And in terms of political imaginaries, just think of Lenin's gesturing always to the horizon, saying there's where we're going, to John F. Kennedy's famous dictum of the new frontier. And on the other hand, is it shared with artistic imagination, from classical landscape painting to postmodern installation and Gesamtkunstwerke? Now, in order to untangle these questions, I will first maybe stress how I will use the term imaginary, because I'll use it in a very specific sense that has nothing to do with the well-known usage of it in Lacanian theory. Instead, I'll refer to the thinking of the philosopher Cornelius Castoriadis, who has written on societies as symbolic constructions held together by specific social, historical imaginaries and institutions. Societies are not created through natural rationalism or historical progressive determinism, but, he says, instituted through creation, through imagination. Society and its institutional forms and norms are thus as much fictional as functional. Society is what Castoriadis famously called an imaginary institution, and I'll just quote him briefly from his major work of that title from 1975, where he wrote, "That which holds society together is, of course, its institution, the whole complex of its particular institutions, what I call the institution of a society as a whole. the word institution being taken here in the broadest and most radical sense. Norms, values, language, tools, procedures, and methods of dealing with things and doing things, and of course, the individual itself, both in general and in a particular type and form, for instance, their differentiations, man, woman, and so on, given to it by the society considered, end of quote. So these institutions are what we can call ways of instituting, meaning instituting subjectivity, legality, political, social relations, and so on. And these forms of instituting may appear to us as a more or less coherent whole, as a unity, but they can appear that way only through continued practice and belief. This also means, conversely, that these social imaginaries can be redefined through other practices, or, as Castoriadis write, collapse when no longer viewed as adequate, just, or true. So in his view, social change occurs through discontinuity rather than continuity, either in the form of radical innovation and creativity, such as Newtonian physics, or in the shape of symbolic and political revolutions. Surely, Paris in 1789, and perhaps Eastern Europe in 1989. But such revolutions can never be predicted or understood in terms of determinate causes and effects or any inevitable historical sequence of events. Rather, change emerges then through the establishment of other imaginaries without predeterminations, through practice and will that establish another way of instituting, what we could hear today in our terms call the establishment of another horizon. This work, whether artistic or political, or both at the same time, then requires a radical break with the past in terms of language and symbolization, and thus of ways of doing things, in effect creating a new language in which to say things, not just saying the same things with new words. So, whereas this theory of the imaginary society has its ontological claims, in the sense that there can be no society that does not imagine itself, that is not instituted, this is by no means a tautological proposition. Indeed, Castoriadis focused on the idea of autonomous societies brought forward through radical imagination in his political and revolutionary thinking. And he defined autonomous societies as being in contrast to heterotonomous ones. While all societies make their own imaginaries, as I said before, institutions, laws, traditions, beliefs, behaviors, and so on, autonomous societies are those in which their members are aware of the fact and explicitly self-institute. In contrast, the members of heteronomous societies attribute their imaginary order to something outside, to some extra social authority, typically God, but also could be tradition and or progress, historical necessities, and so on. So a kind of orthodoxy, whether it be, say, Marxist orthodoxy or one of a religious kind, where a grander narrative of social and natural forces determine or destine and directs the role that we as individuals and collectives can take within it. So we could maybe today argue that liberal democracy and free market capitalism is instituted as a fundamental and historically inevitable category, as an extra societal authority conditioning society from the outside. The market is presented as a natural law, even a deity, we could say, despite liberalism's own claim for rationality and free spirits. And if this is so, how did that become our horizon, if it is our horizon? When did this become a dominant narrative? Surely, as wholly implemented as it seems in political and bureaucratic structures of our everyday lives, or a term we will return to and has already discussed our spaces of experience, it is also, of course, something that is heavily contested. I'm sure it's contested by most people in this room, even detested. No? Whether from anti-globalization, fundamentalist Islam, or other movements imagining another world than the current hegemon. The question of such a horizon, and here we have one horizon, this is a billboard by the British art group Free that I think is sitting somewhere here on the expensive seats, or cheap seats, I don't know. So the question of such a horizon, its coming into being, as well as its possible demise and alternatives, is, I believe, what lies at the heart of the whole Former West project. This has to do with the imagination of possible futures from a specific point in the recent past, the year 1989. Now, the events of that year, as we have heard, and the so-called end of real existing communism and the advent of a former East, has often been articulated as the triumph of the West, or former West, that then could institute an endless equilibrium of liberal democracy and global capital growth. Indeed, this has also been formulated as an end of history by Francis Fukuyama and others, which would also mean then the end of any horizon as a possible futurity. As it is well known, Fukuyama and his followers saw the end of communism as the end of history. But this, I think, would mean two things that are very strange. This would mean, if this is the end of history, that first of all, communism, that only communism was truly historical. After communism, there is no more history. So that means only communism could be historical. And secondly, it means that liberal democracy is then ahistorical in the sense that it is exactly beyond history, beyond the horizon, we can say, that it is eternal. It's because if history has ended, we must be in eternity, not reality. Obviously, history didn't end, and new conflicts and antagonism arose immediately after 1989, partly identitarian, but also economic, and this was well before, of course, the credit crunch of 2008. But I don't want to look at a chain of events as any kind of empirical data disputing this idea of the end of history, but rather examine it as the curious ontological proposition it is, namely that our horizon, understood as surroundings and sense of direction, is actually horizonless. That's the next image. This is also a photograph of a horizon by Olafur Eliasson. If we look at the notion of the horizon within phenomenology, leaving aside aesthetic and political usages of the term for a moment, and maybe not going to Husserl, but to Merleau-Ponty, he writes about something very specific that he calls the object horizon. It's a very simple concept. As that which guarantees the identity of the objects throughout exploration and which places the gaze in relation to things in space. And to the spatial, very simple spatial idea of the horizon, he crucially adds the temporal. Merleau-Ponty writes in the Phenomenology of Perception, "Each moment of time calls all others to witness. It shows by its advent how things were meant to turn out and how it will all finish. Each present permanently underpins a point of time which calls for recognition from all the others, so that the object is seen at all times as it is seen from all directions and by the same means, namely the structure imposed by a horizon." This is, of course, a doubling of the horizon, which is, in effect, a horizonless horizon, right? So, simply put, we can say that without, just in phenomenology, this double horizon of retention and pretension, without it, we are not able to see. We are not able to project, to imagine. And seen in this light, with this first definition of the horizon, the idea of an end of history can no longer be viewed as simply naive or an over-optimistic representation by the right, but as something much more sinister, a falsification of our view of the world, a deliberate depresentation in the attempt to once and for all exorcise the specter that is communism from the world. There is, therefore, as I also mentioned before, though, an aporia in this construction of a horizonless horizon, itself a logical impossibility, namely the equation of communism with history. Since the end of communism signals the end of history, this also means that we are, in a negative sense, bereft of any idea of historical progress and therefore of any future in terms of progress. That liberal democracy and capitalism has no claims for progress. For if it is history's endpoint, and that this endpoint is achieved through the defeat of historical communism in the broadest sense of the term, which would mean that the Sex Pistols were right when they said we have no future. This would also mean that the advent of a former East, in the sense of being a post-communist condition, indicate that there is by definition, or would this also mean, that there is by definition then a former West. If there's a former East, does that bring in to being, as its double, the former West? I don't know. Well, as we know, the end of real existing communism in the Eastern Bloc also had huge ramifications for the left in Western Europe. No? Here I'm not only thinking of the failure of the social democratic project, you could also say there's a form of social democracy, which must of course be historically located earlier to the mid-1970s, but the fact that socialist parties and so-called Eurocommunists despite having been critical of the Soviet Union and long since left that international behind, all had major problems of credibility and some even dissolved following 1989, which I think was, of course, exactly one of the aims and certainly effects of the depresentation by the new rights and its fiction of the end of history. Indeed, as it has been argued, as it has been argued by Nancy Fraser, among others, what can be termed the post-socialist condition, her term rather than post-communism, is characterized by the lack of any overarching project of social justice and redistribution. In other words, the lack of any discernible horizon. But if the horizon always stands in an inverse relationship to experience, this would also mean the cancelling out of experience itself, a depresentation of possible pasts as futures, which was, of course, exactly what was attempted. The so-called post-communist, or as it has been known in some quarters, post-political situation must be viewed as post-horizontal, and therefore as a logical, not only a logical impossibility, but really a falsification of reality. Of course, how we view the horizon as a common feature, as a shared futurity, depends on our location, not only in terms of geography and ideology, but also inherited and projected subject position. We may posit the horizon as universal, but simultaneously any horizon obviously depends on where you stand, on your point of view, not just in terms of phenomenology, but also in terms of geopolitics. Additionally, the horizon is not only spatial, as we saw, but also temporal, and is thus not only connected to possible future scenarios and ways of living and thinking, but also to real and imagined pasts, in the form of residues and traditions, as well as possibilities lost and found. And this is why I've suggested to say that we can see the horizon as a kind of vector of probability, prognosis, and expectation, not only to our past and present sense and space of experience, but also to possible futures. Now, writing at the time of the upheavals of 1989, in a book tellingly entitled New Reflections on the Revolution of Our Time, Ernesto Laclau, who will be speaking on Sunday, describes the horizon as a suicidal self-image that unifies experience. And as such, this could be a second definition that also disputes the idea of the end of history. Here, the horizon is a floating signifier, with different unifying images being produced in different historical periods, and I suppose we could add geographical locations, in order to hold them together and give them direction. And this is, as Laclau mentions, it was natural order for the Renaissance, reason for the Enlightenment, science for positivism, and we could add maybe progress for modernity. However, the postmodern condition, both before and after 1989, has placed such categories under critical scrutiny, even deconstruction. And as such, and all such images are seen as limited rather than limitless. We therefore arrive at the horizon as a limit concept, as a third definition. And I think this has to be understood in two ways, the idea of the horizon as a limit. First, there is the idea of a limitless horizon of progress, growth, and so on, that has been deeply questioned. As Laclau writes, I quote, "After decades, even centuries, of announcing the arrival of the new, it is as if we have reached a point of exhaustion and mistrust the outcome of all experimentation," end of quote. The new, then, is a receding horizon, and the future no longer holds an infinite number of limitless advancements. Secondly, there is the notion of the horizon as a line, which also means that it's a limit, something that can quite literally never be reached. This was also mentioned before, right? As we move closer to the horizon, it also shifts and moves correspondingly further away. So as an image, and here we have one of the seascapes, famous seascapes of Sugimoto, so as an image, a unifying signifier, the horizon has impossibility as well as possibility built into it. It is something that we can decide to move towards and that could give us a sense of direction, but which can never be surpassed. It is always out there, even though we can hardly see it in this photograph. which means, on the one hand, that it can never be reached, but also that it can never disappear, never stop. It may occur blurry at times, and our view can even be directly blocked, but the horizon remains as that which rounds and grounds experience. There cannot be a society, an organization of the social and political, without the positioning of a horizon in this sense. This is what we can call a general condition of horizontality. And this is interesting because the term horizontality, as opposed to horizon, we often think of as the lack of an overview, of being on a singular plane. Perhaps this is indeed the situation we find ourselves in today, in the former West, that we are horizontally situated, but that we cannot see the horizon, as in this image. Simultaneously, horizontality has long been one of the prime metaphors, if not imaginaries, of so-called postmodern or, if you will, contemporary art, right? Often described as horizontal, both as a way of describing the basic features of contemporary art, as well as perhaps its politico-aesthetical aspirations. Just think about the many quotations of Deleuzean theory in art criticism and especially curating, such as the image of the rhizome, or the many discussions on relationality, as well as the ideas of art producing equal communities, where there are no claims for hierarchy, verticality, or transcendence, but plenty for presence, being, and openness, all mainly horizontal metaphors. However, if the horizon is to be understood as a floating signifier that unifies experience, that creates a worldview, how can we see its placement as central to both, or we can see its placement as central to both art and politics, as an image of possible futures, goals and aims, and this is both in negative and positive terms, both in terms of the possible and the impossible. You know, it has the negativity built into it, as I said. So positioning the horizon as an image, not just a metaphor, implies aesthetics. Not only the aesthetics of politics and political movements, but also the politics of aesthetics. Perhaps we can even argue for the figure of the horizon as the way in which art and politics should be connected. An exhibition of art always sets up a horizon. And I think we saw this very clearly in Julie's presentation just before. It always sets up a horizon in the sense of a proposal of what can be imagined and what cannot be imagined. And art, therefore, not only partakes in certain imaginaries, or as some would have it, hegemonies, but it's also the producer of such imaginaries, and therefore of other ways of imagining and imaging the world, as well as other possible worlds. We could also say that art has the capacity to thematicize the very situating of the horizon, with all its contingencies, histories, institutions and struggles, as well as limits. Imaginaries can become visible precisely through how a horizon is staged, positioned, blurred, circumvented and reconstructed within artistic practices and especially current ways of exhibition making. And I would like to focus on the idea of exhibition making for a particular reason, since an exhibition is always an assemblage of objects and positions placed in a spatial and discursive relation to each other and its spectators, providing, if you will, a horizontal line. a line that makes both viewing possible and actual, as well as delimiting it, conditioning it. And as with the object horizon, this staging is not only spatial, but also temporal. In the time, of course, in terms of the time that it takes to move through an exhibition, to see the various works, whether they are time-based or not, but also in a more general sense, in terms of the time of the day, for instance, that you view an art exhibition, meaning, really, the spare time available for the spectator for leisure and so on, as well, of course, art historical time. Each exhibition placed on a timeline of other exhibitions, both in a given site and beyond it. And finally, the relation between horizontality and space-time divisions or continuums can be found in the imaging of art itself. So whereas in the classical age of art, there was always a continuum of time and space within horizontality, nearness and distance indicating a movement in time, such as in landscape painting. Modernist painting famously condensed time and fused it with space, such as cubism. But contemporary art has to some extent reintroduced time, and again, not just in time-based works, video and so on, but also through the spatialization of the subject that is installation practices, but with the crucial difference from classical art that we're working mainly with a discontinuity rather than continuity of time. We could say that the installation is an experiment in horizontality, and that the exhibition can function in this way as a model for a future society. But whereas political experiments and decisions follow the logic of doing something that leads to social and economic effects that then has to be measured, contemporary art introduces a crucial if to the equation. Or to quote Lee Lozano in her notebooks, if I do this, then what will happen? This is in a way the challenge of conceptual and contemporary art, that it's the experiment, it's the imaginary experiment, say, if this was actual, then what would happen? This is exactly the case also of this famous film of Lindsay Anderson that imagines a revolution in the English school system, but ends with it ends with armed struggle, but then with the word if. So to say, this is all a sort experiment, if you will. In more ideological terms, we can say that where the horizon was posited as an image of the future, even a brighter future, in the Enlightenment and within the modernist project, and thus to the idea of movement and progress, so long key terms within both modernist political thought and artistic practice, it is in the postmodern and in the post-communist, if you will, present day, mostly seen as a limit. That which cannot be surpassed, that which cannot yet be experienced but only imagined. Maybe this is the idea of the barrier that we then return to. For both aesthetics and politics then, it becomes a matter of what horizon can be imagined as well as the ways in which to institute it. How a horizon must be placed in order to be effectual, as nearby or far away, unattainable, which all presupposes, naturally, that the horizon is an absolute limit that cannot be surpassed, as such understood as an image in phenomenology translated into political practice, which is not really historically accurate. As we know from history, it is perfectly possible for a political project to reach, if not its conclusion, then some sort of ending, closure, or finishing. Otherwise, we could not talk about a post-communist condition, or for that matter, a former West, regardless of how debatable these terms might be to us. In any case, empires always end, and political movements dissolve as much when their goals are reached, and not only, if ever, when they are suppressed or defeated. Which brings me then to the fourth definition of the horizon concept, which is the one that we already heard about earlier, namely the relation between expectation and experience, which is has to do with mainly historical time, and Reinhard Koselleck, who employed the terms space of experience as the contrast to the term horizon of experience. These were, of course, formal and meta-historical categories. Now, as categories, space of experience and horizon of expectation stand in an inverse relationship to each other, where one depends on the other. In other words, what one expects, both personally and politically, has to do with what one has experienced, and experience is always conditioned by what one expected, as we also heard. But this does not mean that they are mirror images, since one can never be fully deduced from the other. The experience of an event, for example, be it a political event or the visit to an exhibition, is likely to change over time, while the event remains the same. And with different experiences, expectations and prognosis over the future are likely to change. And I think this is what is at play also, of course, in the restaging of historical political protest as an art project by Sharon Hayes in this project called In the Near Future that we have a still image of here, one of the revisited slogans. And this has ramifications for the horizon as a limit, both aesthetically and political, as well as for their intersection. Again, according to Koselleck, and I quote, he writes, The horizon is that line behind which a new space of experience will open, but which cannot yet be seen. The legibility of the future, despite possible prognosis, confronts an absolute limit, for it cannot be experienced. So, end of quote. The horizon is then, in this view, not just that which cannot be overcome or surpassed, but something that shifts in relation to experience and has bearing on its position, and this has bearing on its position within both political imaging and artistic imagination. So, in other words, if a specific horizon of expectation, that is, a society to come, for example, is proceeded as by a political project, it has to be related to concrete located spaces of experience. It has to be perceived as visible, not just in terms of vicinity, but in terms of imagination, that other world is possible from this real world. Similarly, the proposition made by an exhibition, a certain claim for art and society and their interrelation, must have meaning within experience, even when proceeding something as phantasmagoric. At the same time, should a certain horizon be surpassed in terms of history, such as the so-called end of history, this would inevitably create a new space of experience. Indeed, this is said to have been one of the problems of historical communism, as for every utopian fulfillment. Once the horizon has been reached, political goals achieved, so on, such as emancipation, equality, etc., what will then be the horizon of the new space of experience? In other words, what will be the horizon on the other side of this horizon? So not only that the horizon is unattainable, but should it actually be crossed in terms of politics, inevitably there will have to be another one in this phenomenological argumentation. So for the field of cultural production, and more narrowly the practice that of exhibition making, this has several consequences. First of all, that we acknowledge that an exhibition, however speculative, is not only a horizon, but always a horizon in relation to a space of experience, both past and present. So, the space of experience is not only the exhibition itself and a concrete institution that holds it, but also past experiences with exhibitions in this space as well as in others, and in addition, experiences with other institutional spaces that are not those of the art institution. And finally, experiences outside this context altogether. So perhaps it is the lack of such considerations that provide some of the difficulties that I think many of us have with exhibitions being political, not just about the political. Not to get caught up in a simplifying argument of institutional critique, but it goes without saying that a single exhibition or artistic gesture cannot easily or instantly undo institutions' ways of instituting without simultaneously transforming the institution itself. The exhibition is thus caught between these different meanings of the horizon. On the one hand, they are both grounded and rounded by the horizon of the present, in other words, hegemonic social order and imaginaries, but on the other hand, they always, in themselves, attempt to set up a horizon, be it the reigning one or an alternative to it. In any case, the readability of this depends on spaces of experience, on the spaces of experience of others in relation to their horizon of experience, thus at least a double vision. But can the aesthetic experience also, like political events, create rupture? That is, be not only the installment of a certain horizontal line, but also the crossing of this line? Can an exhibition be the passage to a new space of experience where a new horizon will become visible? And I think the idea of former West is exactly to propose such a horizon. But can we also say that the former West is a space of experience? Not yet something to be, but something already lived. Which is a way of saying that the end of history is the end of a specific Western idea of history, a specific history of self-fulfillment and expansion, and that we are perhaps in a state of retrenchment and conservation in the West, or in the former West, and not equilibrium and endless spread of its assumed universal values of liberty and capital, which would then mean, on the one hand, to accept the ideas of historical ends, and horizonlessness, but not as closure but or fulfillment, but as failure. Certainly recent cultural political events, and I insist on calling them so due to the culturalization of politics, where all cultural matters, such as multiculturalism and hybridity, for example, not to mention experimental life and art forms, are immediately political ones, and where political decisions instantly claim cultural references and not least a cultural reasoning. And to bear evidence to such notion, you know, it has a long history, actually, from the idea of Fortress Europe by former British PM John Major, to the concept of livability introduced by the late Pim Fortuyn in Holland and beyond. Many other versions of this idea of conservation. In a way, the new center-right consensus that is sweeping Europe with its xenophobia and cultural conservatism has perhaps understood the formerness of the West very well, but insist on thinking of it in terms of restoration and return. But can one return to a horizon that has already been surpassed? As we know, time travel is not yet in the realm of the possible, not even if this time travel wants to go to an imagined past and not to actual past events. In a way, this preservative view of the world could be analyzed as a collective psychosis that is nonetheless possible to correlate into actuality as long as it can sway democratic institutions, no matter how disastrous the results, not only for those who are othered, but surely also for those who want to remain the same. So, is there another way of being former or of becoming former West? A way that does not reimagine the past in order to escape the future, but rather accepts the loss of centrality and hegemony and embraces the condition of horizontality as acts of emancipation, ways of undoing as ways of doing anew, doing differently. And here we must return to the idea I mentioned at the outset, which is a contrast to the idea of expectation, of course, which is the notion of radical imagination, which is of Castoriadis, which is where art has a crucial role to play as what I have called vectors of the possible, posing questions of possibility and vicinity, as well as making invisible limits visible within the ontology of the horizon. Yeah. I have to go back to the first image. Sorry. They can, as the image behind me, on the side of me, discuss and assess how a horizon must be placed in relation to both experience and expectation in order to be effectual, how far and how close. But this, of course, must always be a collective undertaking, done by all of us present today, thinking about tomorrow. Now, a recent exhibition project that I visited in Brazil, curated by a group of young artists, bore the title In the Shadow of the Future. So the future is simply something that shadows over the present in their context. This is particularly pertinent in Brazil, that of course sees itself as a future global player with a very wide horizon, and it's a country with a huge population under 25. What this group of young artists asked, however, was what it would mean for them to be objects of projection of future for a whole society, and try to place this in relation to history, to the history of art in Brazil, pointing to the fact that artists of the modern period attempted to create a matrix for art and modernization in the works, but where there is no artistic movement, they feel, produced by artists today, but only individual movement in terms of career advancement. Does this indicate a lack of imagination, even among those that literally embody the future, in this case the young artist? If this is so, however, we must all turn this question upon ourselves, especially those from the West and those in the West who attempt to become former. Walter Benjamin, a writer who only partially wrote about horizons in his concept of past as future, wrote in his Arcades project the following pertinent lines. And I quote, "The present, however, already stands to the recent past as the awakening stands to the dream. Every epoch, in fact, not only dreams the one to follow, but in this dreaming, participates its awakening. End of quote. Now, Benjamin's perhaps most sympathetic contemporary reader, Susan Bock-Moss, has expanded on this notion in her important book on the two modernities and the post-communist condition after 1989, tellingly titled Dream World and Catastrophe, where she wrote the following lines, which would also be my response to the young Brazilians today, and I quote, Benjamin wrote, we must wake up from the world of our parents. But what can be demanded of a new generation if its parents never dream at all? Thank you.